There is a lot of people involved, not even just with the PD, but also communications and public works, that really rallied around and made a really difficult situation to be a good situation. And then on the flip side, is actually a really interesting week. We had a lot of highs and a lot of lows, but it was a good week. Again, on the other side, with the announcement of Agilent and the great press release, credit to the team and even people before us. But I know from the time that I started here at the town of Frederick, we've been having meetings with Agilent almost on a weekly to every other week basis. And so that's credit to economic development, to Ryan, to Max, to Ali, to Marine, to building, to engineer. I know Kevin and Sarah and Jason. There is a host of a lot of people that have been involved in this for many of years. And I think it's really important just to celebrate that. As in addition to that, it's very unusual, and I know that's work of the team that they did back there, and having a state put out a press release and to also quote the jurisdiction, the mayor of the jurisdiction. Typically, it's just the state that provides their own release. So that's a big win. And so with that, I might have Ryan come up just for a couple of minutes and just talk briefly about some upcoming events that you're going to see on your calendar. And so certainly reach out to us if you have any questions as we get more details on the events.
Thank you, Brian. Good evening, Madam Mayor and trustees. It's good to be here with you this evening. Hopefully you've had the opportunity to see some of the communications that's gone out in the last 24 hours regarding Agilent and their plans to expand in Frederick. Certainly exciting news for Frederick and for the community. And we're starting to get a pretty good reach with a lot of that news as well. We've had national site selectors reach out congratulating the staff on the project, which that alone by itself is a really hard thing to do, to get on the radar of a site selector when there's 80,000 communities in the United States. And to a site selector, you are a data point on a spreadsheet. And that's how that works. And so for them to associate a community with projects that are happening is a really, really big deal. So we have that. The Denver Post put out an article yesterday on the project. I think actually our economic development manager, Max, shared that post. As of the end of the business day today, we had already counted 1,300 impressions of where that one post has gone. The Colorado Bioscience Association, which is the state trade association for the life sciences, both pharmaceuticals and other like R&D type stuff. They put out a release also talking about how impactful this is for Colorado. So again, this has nothing to do with Frederick. This is a Colorado win to see this level of investment in life sciences. So really pretty exciting news. A hold was placed on your calendars for February 14th of all days, Valentine's Day. That is the tentative date that is being targeted for a groundbreaking ceremony. This is being planned, really is being spearheaded by Agilent, but we're working with the governor and the governor's office to see if we can get him out here. So that date may shift depending on the availability of the CEO of Agilent out of Santa Clara and the availability of the governor. But we were asked to place that hold on there, and we'll get more details. It sounds like they have kind of a plan to address that regardless of the weather. It sounds like the general contractor for the project is leasing a building across the street, so we can be indoors where they can have pretty renderings and we can do some of that stuff and limit the amount of time we're actually physically outdoors. And so we'll kind of work through that, but wanted to get that on your radar. It's not often we get these opportunities, so we'll get more information as we kind of plug through that. And also get a list of kind of the dignitaries that may be in attendance that day. The Weld County Commissioners already have a hold on their calendar as well for the 14th too. So I know that there's some other state entities and some federal agencies that are also being tapped for their availability as well. So I can answer any questions that you might have at this time, but wanted to make sure that you saw that hold on your calendar.
Exciting. Really exciting.
Amazing. Yeah.
Your work is done. Congratulations.
It's a pretty good start to the year, so.
Just go out on top.
pretty good mic drop right there.
No, not at all. And actually, it's funny, the very, very next day, actually yesterday, we had meetings as a team about, you know, trying to do what we can to get the permit out the door, because we were like so close to getting that permit over the finish line. And I think we're going to tap our relationships with the fire department to help out with a couple of items there. But you know, the amount of pressure you might have with a project like that, it seems it grows once you've announced it to the world it's happening and you just don't have a permit issued yet, because now you have like the weight of a freight train behind you, you know, the collective us to get that permit out the door. But it's all good. There's a very positive movement on that. And the team is really what's been amazing. We've taken time to meet with the engineering team today. Brian and I met and just expressed appreciation and thanks. We met with the community and economic development team yesterday, did the same thing, because it's really a lot of that that's kind of carried things along the way. I'm just some guy who, you know, has been here not even 2 years that could be a part and small part in this whole thing. So it's really everybody else. So it's a great win for Frederick.
I'm not super knowledgeable on these types of businesses, but you know, like when aerospace goes into an area, it seems like you get about 10 of them around. I mean, does that go on with this type of business too, where you could end up with an area where there's a bunch of different
absolutely
companies doing the same thing?
That's actually what the Colorado Bioscience Association, their press release, talked about, is how it will be a magnet in the region, maybe not necessarily in that business park, but yeah, in the region, it will be a magnet for other bioscience and life sciences companies. And because you're right, because these smaller companies, they want to locate where these magnets are. That's why CU Boulder is a strong magnet, because the universities and the federal office, the labs that are there. But this is one of those projects that has the potential to do the same type of thing for Frederick and for the region.
Exciting.
Yep. Thank you all for the heavy lift and the work you guys have done and the support.
Thank you, Ryan.
Yes, thank you.
Well done.
Yes, very well done. It's been exciting to hear. I don't know if you've had residents reach out to you and ask you questions, or if you've had comments or questions or anything regarding, not much, no?
Zero.
No one's called for you, Mark. So just
nobody called me.
Oh, that's right. You guys have numbers switched.
People in Greeley.
Yeah.
Nobody from anybody here.
Yeah, that would make sense a little bit. I don't think people understand or comprehend the effect that this will have on our community positively. But what I've appreciated in the multitude of press releases that have gone out is there's an underlying value that's different in each one. And each demographic of peoples sees something great about this opportunity. So whether it's adding jobs, the governor cited that himself, which was incredible. We mentioned that in our press release. Whether it's residents interested in seeing that there's one area of land that will focus on this kind of infrastructure that's related to industrial and manufacturing and kind of life sciences. So there's an area, they know what's coming, they know what to expect. So I've heard that benefit. You know, I've heard a benefit of strategic partnerships. So every time you turn around, someone mentions a different positive value to this new opportunity. So it's really pretty incredible. This is just the beginning of that conversation too. So more people will hear and see it soon. Exciting. Congratulations. Yeah.
Congratulations to you guys. It also speaks to last week in the study session that Max had, just that one slide where over 272 jobs have already come to Frederick because of that policy, and this only adds to it. So it helps us to be competitive in a, I would say, not just within a region, but within a state. I think Frederick's competing now within the state very competitively.
Yeah, we've been fighting for such a long time, it feels like, to not just be a number, not just be a speck on a map or a data point, and really not even to just argue for a seat at the table. We have very important things to say from Frederick, and our residents deserve people like you and your teams who have advocated on their behalf and said, no, we don't have to settle. We can chart our own destiny, and we can tell the narrative of our residents and our guests and our businesses on what we look like. This is an exact reflection of that, of being that grounded and being intent, you know, having intent for the agenda that our residents set forth. So pretty powerful. Thank you. And yes, hearing more ways we can support our PD would be helpful, please.
Yeah, I suspect mayor and trustees in the coming, after some things settle down in the next probably 45 days or so, we'll have some conversations and do something to, as a board, as an organization to help with that. So there'll be more information coming on that.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments on the town manager's admin report? Nope. All right, town clerk's report, please. Thank you, Brian.
Mayor Kreitz, in your packet is a copy of the town clerk's report. As a follow-up to the February 14th date, knowing that you will have the groundbreaking to attend and knowing that you all have loved ones that you would want to spend time with. Mayor Kreitz has asked me to bring forward a resolution to cancel that board meeting on that date so you can spend time with your families. So that will be forthcoming on your next agenda as well. Otherwise, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have about my report or any other questions you may have for me.
I got kind of surprised, Megan. You guys probably all know it, but The Butcher and the Blonde has shut down, and apparently they're not, I guess from what I'm gathering, they're going to just be catering only, and it was kind of a surprise. It was disappointing. It was one of my favorite places, but
we were disappointed too, I could tell you.
Yeah.
We lunched there a lot.
Mm-hmm. I bet. They didn't have a liquor license, though.
No. They did not. No.
When, I don't know who was discussing with me, but they said that their model always was to not be in brick and mortar, but COVID kind of pushed them inside.
Right.
Yep.
Which is still disappointing.
Yeah.
I actually think they're very good friends with the owners of Mountain Cowboy, and Mountain Cowboy owners may have convinced them to open as well.
I think they're going to try it. Hope so.
Hopefully get to enjoy their food sometime somewhere else. Even tour and talks, maybe.
Yeah.
Long night meetings.
I love their Philly cheesesteak sandwich.
We all know that Adam loves their fajitas.
Yeah.
That is exciting. Okay. Any other questions for Megan?
Nope. I don't.
You will provide the resolution to remove the or cancel the February 14th meeting, yes?
Yep, I'll put it on your consent.
Okay. I appreciate that you made me sound very thoughtful and kind, that I wanted everyone to spend Valentine's Day with their loved ones. That was not actually my thought. My thought was we have a groundbreaking at Agila, and I wanted your dedication for that. So I'm not nearly as thoughtful as Megan made me sound. But I do hope you enjoy the day. We'll move on to our consent agenda. Our consent agenda items are considered to be routine and will be enacted by one motion and vote. There will be no separate discussion of consent agenda items unless a board member so requests, in which case the item may be removed from the consent agenda and considered at the end of our consent agenda. Would anyone wish to remove one of your two items this evening?
Mayor, I would like to remove the list of bills. I have a question about the El Dorado Artesian Water.
Item D has been requested to be removed from our consent agenda for further discussion.
The direction on the...
Yeah.
Oh. I need a second.
Rest.
Oh, yeah.
We just need a second. We're just looking at...
This is just new territory because I don't think in the 2 years.
Oh, you've never removed anything.
Me either.
We've never removed
That's
anything.
That's why I was like,
I didn't know if we discussed it and made it
now.
Fine and then put it back on or not.
Oh.
You actually don't need a second to remove it.
Okay.
It's just now removed as a standalone item.
Yeah.
So you would just need to handle the remainder of your consent agenda through a motion and a second and a vote.
So a motion to consider item C as part of our consent agenda item we'll address first, and then we'll openly discuss item D. Okay? Motion to approve consent agenda item C.
Madam Mayor, I would like to recommend approval of Consent agenda, item C.
Second.
Trustee Lamont?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Okay, item D, Trustee Lamont, would you share which page you have a question on the list of bills?
It's on page 14 on my computer, but it's listed under El Dorado Artesian Springs, Inc., the water delivery service for almost $23,000.
Okay.
I thought that was high.
Yes.
And I wanted to question that. Go ahead.
Sure. So looking into that, that is a discrepancy. The actual amount we spent to El Dorado for that month of a period was $268. What I'd like to do is take this list back because I believe there's a discrepancy somewhere and confirm where the check is for the $22,977 and bring that back on the 24th with a updated list and showing what the discrepancy, and hopefully that's the only one, but I definitely want to have finance staff come through. I looked at the ones above and the ones below, and they are correct. So somewhere when finance was formatting the report, it got off. So I definitely want to have time to do a full vetting of that report before we bring it back to you guys.
$22,000
No, they only got paid $268. So, but definitely, someone we probably did pay $22,977, so I want to do the research to verify who that was for and what that service was for, especially because of the larger amount.
Yeah. Need Trustee Lamont to go through my bank book.
No kidding. Yes, please.
I'd like to take some $22,000 water.
I'd like to accidentally be paid $22,000.
Yeah, liquid debt.
I was comparing it to CBT, and I'm thinking, wow.
Yeah.
Price for sure. Thank you.
We're drinking gold.
Bringing that to our attention, and again, I definitely want to bring back on the 24th the more updated, accurate report for you guys.
Okay, thank you. And can you, when you do that, you can address this item specifically when bringing it back,
yes.
Or is it bringing it back in the consent agenda?
We'll bring it back as a separate item.
Okay. Item. Thank you. Good catch. Thank you.
I learned something new tonight. That's awesome.
Removing a consent agenda item?
All new world.
Please start singing.
Yes.
Yes. All new world of governmenting.
All right. We have no further consent agenda items. We have an action agenda item E. It's a water night. Yes.
Good evening, Mayor and Board of Trustees. For you today for consideration is the 19th interim agreement for the NISP project, and we're getting close to the end, and I'll touch on that a little bit here as we go through what this agreement will cover work-wise. Just a little bit background again for the NISP project. There's 40,000 acre feet of annual yield proposed for the projects between the two reservoirs, Glade and Galton, shown on the map here. There are 15 participants, one of which is the town of Frederick. Our participation is for 2,600 acre feet of water. That's about 6.5% of the entire project. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not on the right one. Thanks. Sorry about that. Let me go back to the map in case anyone has any questions on that. There we go. So just to give you guys an update on the project status. So back in 2020, the project was given the 401 water quality certification by the Department of Public Health and Environment. Laramie County Commissioners approved the 1041 permit also in 2020, but most recently in December, the Army Corps of Engineers issued the Section 404 Record of Decision. That's the rod that you hear everyone talking about waiting on for the NIST project. So this is quite the milestone for the project. It marks the end of going through multiple decades of investigation into the project to determine if it's the best project to meet the needs of the participants and that it's the least impactful option of alternatives to meet the needs of the participants to have a new water source for Northern Colorado. You guys might be interested. This is their updated project schedule showing the approval, the record of decision in the last half of 2022. There's still design work going underway, environmental mitigation, Highway 287 relocation design, and future construction pipeline pump stations. The first water deliveries, which is what most people ask about, would be in 2032. That's the earliest proposed currently. That is based on the construction schedule, which it's two very large reservoirs. It takes a lot of time to build those reservoirs, as well as getting water into the reservoir so we can get deliveries out of it. So for 2023, the work that's planned for this is additional support for the 404 permit and record of decision. As you guys might remember, there was a document before you that the board approved that further iterated the support of the town to support any type of legal action that needs to be made to support the 404 permit and record of decision. So this ties into that. Potential modifications of the 404 permit, there is no clarity on that point right now. We've had meetings with the NIFS committee, and the conditions under the permit right now are very reasonable, so there's no major concerns of that right now. Developing mitigation, going through the IGA process with Larimer County, as well as public information for the NIST project, making sure that the public who are impacted and might see this project moving forward, just information about the project, why it should be supported, and how it's good for the community that it serves. Additional work is additional design for Glade Reservoir, geotechnical work, the Highway 287 design, as well as contracting for construction management general contractors for the Glade Reservoir and Highway 287 project. That helps to value engineer the project, which means going through the process of identifying risks and how to mitigate that, as well as working through cost estimates for the work to find ways to optimize the project. The group will work to refine the conveyance, and a portion of that, which is important for the town, is looking at potential CBT exchange with the project that would aid in flexibility for the town, since CBT is our primary source currently. Moving forward with the South Platte Water Conservation Project negotiations, that's the portion of the project that works with exchanges with ditch companies, which reduces the amount of buy and dry that could impact this area that the project goes through, which is something that is great for the community, keeping those farms in production. Land and easements for the pipeline going through that area, again, more mitigation. Project financing. Planning is something that's going to be ramping up this year as we get closer to the allotment contract development, making sure that we know how we're going to be paying for this project, if we're going to be in the financing, how much we're going to be paying cash towards the project. That'll be ramping up. So the group will be reaching out to our finance department. And then, as well as going through Fort Collins 1041 permit process, which is something that the city of Fort Collins will be starting this year, which impacts the project as we go through Fort Collins, since there has been significant opposition from Fort Collins in the past for the project. So the participant group and their legal group has been working through that. They have some comments that'll be given to the Fort Collins Council as they bring this forward in a meeting very soon to consider their rules for the 1041 permit process. So how this ties into the 2023 budget. The 2023 budget included about $1.6 million for the NIST project. The actual invoice is going to be slightly less than that. That's because of for the refinement that they did towards the end of the year, as well as rolling over some funds that weren't spent in 2022 over to the 2023 budget. So we can use money that we've already paid into the project for this year as well. That is the end of the information today. We would recommend approval of resolution 23R01.
So when you mentioned that there was objections currently from Fort Collins, is that truly from the city of Fort Collins, or is that, you know, groups like Save the Pooter, or this is truly their council and the city itself has objections?
Yes, to both of those things.
Okay, so Save the Pooter groups as well as the municipality.
Mm-hmm. Without getting too far into the weeds, there's at least one city council person who's ran on the proposition of destroying NISP on their council. So we're aware of that. It's part of the what's happening. The 1041 permitting process, they don't have currently have 1041 regulations, which the state statutes allow those things to happen. And part of the pushback, without getting into the details of it all, because it's potentially sensitive in a public setting, is, you know, NISP generally believes that some of the avenues in their draft regulations that they're proposing are far beyond what the state statute would authorize. And so those are the discussions of how do we work with Fort Collins to get them to a place where, as a fellow municipality, they're able to exercise their jurisdictional rights that they can, but not in a way that would be overly burdensome or overly reaching.
Yeah, it is uncommon for a city to have a 1041 permit process. It's usually just the counties. As you saw on the list, we've gone through that Larimer County process. So it's very uncommon.
Well, and I know this is probably more of a philosophical question, but, you know, the state decides ultimately, you know, how we're using our water resources to provide water to other states. So I suppose, I guess I'm confused on why, if that's a state decision, how is it becoming such a local decision now through Fort Collins? Like, how are they able to monopolize the water that at one point the state said could be distributed to others?
Necessarily the use of the water that they're monopolizing, it's the impacts on the environment the project creates by passing through Fort Collins.
Okay.
It's the point of where the water is proposed to be taken out of the Pooter River is within the city of Fort Collins, and so they'd like to regulate the impact.
Okay. That helps me.
So the 1041 regulations are somewhat dated. They were provided at a time when the state was far less sophisticated and kind of pushed that off to the local jurisdictions to figure out for them. So I don't know that 1041 was anticipated to be utilized in the way it's being utilized, but absent a change in the state statutes and or additional litigation, it is what it is. There has been some recent, you may be aware of the city of Thornton and its issues with Larimer County, and there's a recent court decision that kind of lends towards what we believe to be more a sound reading of the law that we're working with Fort Collins so that it doesn't create a future opportunity for litigation between everyone.
So that ruling was encouraging to you in this scenario with Fort Collins? Okay.
It wasn't a complete slam dunk, but a lot of the reasoning that the court utilized is and clarifying these boundaries was helpful.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm
what was the when you started working on NISP, Sarah, what was the projected total cost of the project, just out of curiosity? Do you remember?
Mayor Kreitz, I think when I first started, it was around 1.5 billion, and that was about 7 years ago.
Okay.
And I think they've spoke that at the very beginning it was one, and now it's two.
Mm-hmm. And I imagine, you know, Sarah, I asked Sarah this question in the agenda review meeting about, you know, at one point there were allocations from each of the shareholders that was dedicated to just litigation. And that was, I don't remember if that was like 16 and 17 or whatever phase that was, or project number that was, or agreement, excuse me. But I imagine you have that sort of thing throughout the process. But I find it interesting that they are trying to phase the development, the litigation, the environmental. They're trying to phase it. I know you can't project those costs, but very difficult concept to explain to the general public. Even just how they've organized it, I think they're trying to find a storyline there to help us as a shareholder provide narrative, but it's a very difficult and complex project to explain to the community on what their benefit is currently to keep investing without, you know, either selling or sharing your shares now, because it looks like we continually just put money into a well. I know that's not true, but so the more, I think maybe the more, what I've learned over the last year is it's important that we talk about these micro commitments to the community. Water is not the sexiest topic, and I don't think residents really want to read a packet, nor do they want to read a ton about NISP on social media, but I do think we can find a way to take this annual agreement, the 19th annual agreement, and say, this is where we started, here's where we're at, and here's ultimately where we're going. And I think it would be important to share that with the community, because at this point, we look like we're not paying attention to where we're funneling dollars into water. I know that's not true, but the perception is that reality for residents. And it's important that we share that each dollar is dedicated to something in this project to get us to that end goal. I think we're missing that right now.
Mayor, we can also work on some, like a communication timeline or story we could put out there. Since this is being approved by the board, that's easy. We'll work with the communications team and develop some timeline that puts this together. Quick question, Sarah. Does Fort Collins, it says that the Fort Collins and Loveland Water District have 3,400 right. acre feet as part of that?
I'm sure they're ecstatic about it.
So serving just a portion of Fort Collins, or because certainly it's still spending. Fort Collins is going to benefit from this project.
Yes.
Just curious.
They talk about that in every meeting.
They do? Mm-hmm. The authority does?
So, too, they really want to come and talk to us. If we want to have, you know, them come and explain where everything's at and stuff, you know, they're definitely open to do that. They keep saying that in every meeting, so.
And it's similar to our relationship with Left Hand, where a good short portion of our community is served by a different water provider.
Right.
That's the relationship that they have up there in Fort Collins. And so part of the discussion that we're having from the legal team is how do we best communicate our concerns in a way that's palatable to the elected body there without creating more frustration. And
mm-hmm. Well, and how much would it benefit when we talk about this, when we put this out there as a narrative, to discuss the percentage of our annual board meetings and study sessions that are devoted to water? And maybe even, you know, a rough estimate of hours. And I say that seriously so that they realize it's not just water, pass, send money, but that it's something that we talk about continuously, thoroughly, exhaustively sometimes, but that we continue to talk about because we realize the importance of it for the future of this town. Because one way, shape, or form, whatever we're going to be in, you know, 27 years, 2050, we're going to be involved, water's going to be part of it. So, I mean, I think just the more information they can say, we don't take this lightly, we don't spin our wheels, we don't pass it in, you know, two meetings and don't talk about it for the year. It's every single month there's some discussion of water because it is so important.
Yeah, I think that'd be helpful. And Trustee Tivaldi, to kind of address your comment, I mean, it's not that they're not welcome to come talk about NISP, but I suppose that's my fault for not inviting them. My philosophy has always been, we have staff that specialize in these conversations, and they bring to us what we need to know, and they are our ambassadors in these conversations. You are our ambassador at those meetings. Otherwise, we could all be in the same meeting every night, every minute of every day. And so the only way we're going to scale productivity in the town of Frederick is to diversify and delegate And you and Sarah have been great at saying, raising your hand to participate. So I trust that if you think we need to know something, you will tell us.
It was more along the lines that if you wanted to have other people in town that were so wanting to know about it, they could hear it from the actual people that are selling it to us.
Sure.
And maybe there's an idea of setting up some neighborhood meeting or
whatever
we'd like to call it, where we have a listening session or an opportunity for those that are to come here, sit in, and listen to the conversation without it being on a board night, on the board agenda presentation, but more of an opportunity for the folks at Northern to come down and provide a community presentation.
Haven't they also said that they'd go to some of those community talks?
Yeah, they may
just answer questions. I mean, in my brief encounter and engagement with the NISP people, they've always, like you said, Trustee Tavalli, that they've always been very open and willing to come down and are more than willing to talk.
Yes, opening up to the community to hear, I think, would be just fine. As long as we serve $22,000 worth of water to them in the meeting.
It's all about timing, and I don't know what the right timing for that sort of thing.
And we can reach out to the folks at Northern. I'm kind of volunteering Sarah to some degree. reach out to them and just kind of get their thoughts as to what that look like. You're right, they are happy to come present and participate. And, you know, ultimately, board meetings may or may not have the audience that's concerned with hearing it. So providing a format or an opportunity for the message to get to the folks that are interested in it, we can work with them to try to figure out what that looks like and when it looks like.
That makes sense to me. Yes.
Yep.
Questions, comments, concerns on your action agenda item?
No. All right.
Okay. Thank you, Sarah.
Thanks. In that case, Madam Mayor, I'd like to recommend approval of Resolution 23-R01. That can't be that hard. It's the first one.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion?
No, I have no more discussion, sorry.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Pivia?
Yes.
Trustee Lamont?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. Okay, trustee reports. Trustee Padilla, I'd like to start with you tonight, please.
I just brought that piece of cake, and since nobody ate it, so that's actually from the NISP congratulatory cake. I thought you could stick it in the freezer, and then in 2032,
I like it.
We're not involved in the form.
Fantastic.
Be interesting if any of us are around still.
No kidding.
At least, you know, in here.
Right.
I don't have anything else.
Thank you for thinking of us. That was nice. Appreciate it.
Nothing.
I'm good. I'm good.
All is well.
Good. I'm glad to hear.
Everything's okay with me.
Good. I'm glad to hear. All right, new year. Anything? Oh, that's right. Yes.
So per your executive session earlier, if there is a trustee that would like to make a motion to direct staff to move forward as discussed in executive session, that would be helpful.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to recommend that we move forward.
As discussed
in executive session.
Okay.
Trustee Tivaldi?
Yes.
Trustee Brown?
Yes.
Trustee Padilla?
Yes.
Trustee Mahan?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem March?
Yes.
Trustee Lamach?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you.
So can I ask a quick question? Can't we just say so moved when you do that? Okay.
Absolutely.
You can.
We can sure.
Nothing to remove February 14th. We're okay. We don't need a motion for that.
Okay. I'll put that on your next agenda and consent.
Okay. Jason Myers, that was the same thing you needed, was a motion. Okay. Good to go. Okay. Thank you all. We're adjourned. Have a good evening. It's almost 9:00.